here that the system of direction is very much in description, not in numbers. You take this road, then when you see this gas station, take a right. Blue van parking, you take a left. And this blue van is always there, you know, it's not gonna move. I was always interested in urban phenomena. The edge of a sidewalk can be magnified onto a large painting. A grass coming out from a wall would be a motif. When I came to Beirut, I refused that part because I understood that what I was doing is very nostalgic to the place I'm in now. So in a way, I kept working with the same interests, but they took a different meaning. And slowly, I started diverting more towards more clear urban issues. How the city is laid, why those neighborhoods are next to each other, how did they become next to each other. You know, being an Arab or growing in the Middle East, boundaries are always there, it's always present. Whether the geographical boundaries or the political boundaries or the social boundaries. And for me, these subjects are questions raised to understand the urban space that I'm living in. There's a good example, which is the map of Beirut, Beirut Caoutchouc. I worked on it in 2003. The government back then started building new expressways and highways to connect the city together. So these expressways became more like barriers between neighborhoods. So this issue was important for me because it was dismantling the city. Back then, the maps of Beirut did not specify the name of the neighborhoods. Sometimes you find maps with the names, but the names are floating above the city, you know, without drawing the lines. So I found myself walking the streets of Beirut with a map and marking all the borders depending on the signage system on the wall. For example, I use the zoning of electricity of Lebanon, which is done not for direction, it's done for the electricity company. Something like this sign would be a sign of a borderline. Because if this is on the left sidewalk and you have this one on the opposite sidewalk, then you know that these are edges of neighborhoods. Architecture is man-made, for sure, and this is why it's special. There is two kinds of implications. One is in the case of wars, and one is the developing one. I've done so far replicas of two different buildings in Beirut. One is the Monument for the Living, which is a tower that was never used as its original function. The importance of this tower, we have to think about it in the 70s. You can see how the tower overlooks all this area. So we know how important it was in military terms. If you're on the 7th floor, you can control a certain street. If you go up to the 20th floor, you can control other streets because, you know, the view change. And usually they used to put a sniper. So he controls the whole area because no one can cross the street anymore. It's an existing memory of the war for the people who still remember the war. Young people look at it as an unfunctional edifice, you know, it's nothing. But for older generations, it is very significant, you know, it's a symbolic monument. Beirut is a very challenging city. The sense of autonomy is very clear in this city, to the point where people get creative in all the services that the government should provide. So there's always improvisation. You must have an alternative route so you don't get stuck in traffic. All the Lebanese drivers know alternative routes. It's part of the character. So you should have a plan B ready and C probably. Other than that, you will be stuck in Beirut all the time, you know, in one place.